This is the 17th and final lecture in a series of lectures giving an introduction to exterior differential systems. In this lecture, we want to give a simple example, the example of conformal maps, and see how we can take advantage of the notion of characteristic variety and the notion of Cauchy characteristics to be able to give some kind of geometric notion about how many conformal maps there are between surfaces. So first, what is a conformal map? A conformal map between surfaces for us means a local diffeomorphism of the surfaces, which preserves angles. By preserving angles, I mean if you draw two curves on S that meet at some angle, at some point, and you then throw them through the map phi to produce curves on S prime, then the angles between those curves at the corresponding point should be exactly the same as the angle between the original curves at the original point. So matching up of angles. Now, that's a geometric condition, and we'd have to work out somehow an exterior differential system in terms of algebraic conditions. So we'll think about that in a minute, but I just want to state a simple theorem about conformal maps, which will be a consequence of a more general theorem that we're actually going to prove. If you have a point on S and a point on S prime on these surfaces, then there is a conformal map taking some neighborhood of that first point to that some neighborhood of that second point, and which is going to take the points to one another. There is such a conformal map. So there's a large collection of conformal maps, and that'll be a consequence, as I said, of a more general result that we'll prove using the Cartan-Kähler theorem. Okay, so what we want to do is to write down an exterior differential system. In order to do that, we need to remember how to write down these differential forms on the frame bundles of surfaces. On a surface S on this frame bundle, we have well-defined soldering and connection forms. We write the soldering forms as a single one-form omega, whose real and imaginary parts are omega 1 and omega 2, the soldering forms of the surface. It's convenient to organize them into a single complex-valued form. This is a real-valued form, alpha. Alpha is the real-valued form gamma 1, 2 from the structure equations of Euclidean space. It's the connection form of that surface. So a soldering form and a connection form, and they're related by this equation here, the structure equation for the surface. And this is the structure equation for the surface S prime. In terms of those structure equations, we can write down our exterior differential system. Now, we have to figure out how to describe conformal maps in terms of some kind of infinitesimal condition. And I'll leave you to check that a map is conformal between surfaces if and only if in a suitable orientation, once you suitably orient the surfaces to match up, the soldering forms match up to a positive multiple. That just means, in other words, that this linear transformation of tangent spaces is just a positive rescaling by a positive real number. Now, it's convenient to write positive real numbers as exponentials of real numbers, and that we'll do that here. It'll be convenient for our algebraic computations to write that number, that positive scaling factor, as the exponential of negative u for some function u. The minus sign is just for convenience of calculation, and the fact we write it as an exponential is also just for convenience of calculation. But the fundamental idea is simply that this is a linear transformation by a positive scaling factor up to choice of the bases E1 and E2, orthonormal bases. So that's the equation for having a conformal map. We'll make E1 and E2 match up to positive scaling, and that will be given by this equation here. And that's going to be the equation for our exterior differential system on the product frame bundles. We have two surfaces, S and S prime. We have their frame bundles. We take the product of the frame bundles, and we impose this exterior differential system given by this equation here. It's a complex equation. It's in complex-valued one-form, so it has real imaginary parts. And that's the equation for conformal mapping. Okay, so we're going to look for integral manifolds for that equation. Each conformal map will give an integral manifold of that exterior differential system, and it's an integral 3 manifold. It's three-dimensional because it's really just giving taking the frame bundle of surface S, and then for each frame, E1, E2, E3, we can see what the conformal map, say phi, does to E1, E2. It'll map them to its derivative. We'll map them to some E1 prime, E2 prime, up to a positive multiple. And so that'll be our multiple e to the minus u. And then e3 is determined up to plus or minus, and e3 prime. E3 prime is also determined up to plus or minus. So that 3 manifold may have many components. It's not necessarily connected because we have choices of the e3 and e3 prime, but they're irrelevant to our calculation. Nevertheless, we can see the 3 manifold because we get to pick a point of the surface S, and then we get to pick a frame e1, e2 on S, and we map it. So this will give us a 3-dimensional integral manifold of that exterior differential system. And of course, as usual, I leave you to check that that you can reverse the process. Given an integral manifold of that system, you can locally at least show that it arises from a conformal mapping. And I'll leave you to check that. If you differentiate, what am I differentiating? I'm differentiating the exterior differential system here. This is the equation for our exterior differential system, so omega prime equals e to the minus u omega, or we could write it as omega prime minus e to the minus u omega is the generator for the exterior differential system. Differentiate that and you find this equation, which I'll leave you to check, that du plus I alpha prime minus alpha is some complex multiple u prime of omega. Okay, so it's just this expression here that arises from differentiating the previous one for some complex number u prime. We can write that as a tableau, this guy, wedge omega, right? When we take the exterior derivative of the previous, of the one form that generated the exterior differential system, we find exactly this two form. Now, it's a tableau in a sense, but this is really just a one-by-one complex matrix. So you don't really need to write it with all these parentheses around it. It's really a one-by-one complex matrix. We can calculate its characters. The character S1 is 2 because there are two forms here. There's a real part and an imaginary part. Okay, because that's a complex valued form, it has a real imaginary part, and so we get those real imaginary parts counted as 2, and then S2 is 0. So, as usual, we can leave you to details of checking the linear algebra and make sure that this is right. That's in involution because you get an integral element here parameterized by a choice of u prime, an arbitrary complex number. So that u prime has real and imaginary parts, and that corresponds to the two here. There's a real part and imaginary part, so two parts, and S1 is 2. So the system's in involution with solutions depending on two functions of one variable. Okay, so that's the Cartan-Kähler theorem done. Now we have to look for the characteristic variety, and I leave you to check that this guy has empty characteristic variety. There are no real characteristics of this system. So that tells us, therefore, that every possible choice of integral curve is non-characteristic and so lies in an integral surface. So all we have to do is figure out how to calculate out geometrically what those integral curves are, and then we'll know that they lie in integral surfaces. So let's think about that. So it's an involution, and we'd have no characteristics, so we get to pick an arbitrary integral curve. How do we pick an arbitrary integral curve? First of all, let's think about Cauchy characteristics. And in this case, just as we had before, there's no alpha plus alpha prime one form appearing, so the dual vector field to that one form has to be a Cauchy characteristic. So we can predict the existence of a one-dimensional space of Cauchy characteristics, and so we'll be able to quotient one dimension lower. So we're working from a six-dimensional product of frame bundles, we'll be able to go down in dimension to 5 dimensions. We can also quotient by these discrete symmetries, E2 and E2 prime, we can reflect together. If we reflect them together so the orientation still corresponds, then we get still an integral manifold of our system. We can also reflect E3, and we can reflect E3 prime independently of one another and independently of what we do with E2 and E2 prime. So those are various symmetries that we can quotient by, which have no effect on our exterior differential system, as you can easily check. So we have a continuous one-parameter family of symmetries arising from the Cauchy characteristic of alpha plus alpha prime, which again represents rotating the tangent space of the surface S and simultaneously rotating the tangent space of S prime at the corresponding points. So that gives us one parameter family of rotations that are symmetries of the system and that are Cauchy characteristic symmetries. And then we have these discrete symmetries that we can also quotient by. So when we quotient out by all that, what's left over? What's left over is a quotient space, M bar, which is the set of conformal linear maps of tangent planes. You can see that the linear map is still well defined because we've simultaneously reflected E2 and E2 prime, or we've simultaneously rotated E2 and E1 prime, E2 prime. So the conformal linear map between them still survives. It has a conformal factor of E to the minus U. So that quotient space is certainly going to have all those conformal linear maps. Those are all going to be there, but there's nothing else. And I'll leave you to check that to convince yourself that that's all there is. There isn't, for example, a choice of some a normal vector because we allowed E3 to be reflected, and similar with E3 prime, and allow them to be reflected independently of one another. So there's really no normal defined to these tangent planes. So we've got this quotient, and it gives these conformal linear maps, and that's all we have, right? Then, so that's the quotient space, and you have to pick a curve in there, which should be an integral curve of this system. So omega prime should be e to the minus u omega. And if you think about it, it's not too hard to figure out how you do that. You just take a curve on S, and then use omega prime as that positive multiple omega to calculate what the value of the function u is all the way along as you travel along the corresponding along some curve in S prime. So you get to pick curves and match them up. So we get the fact that the characteristic variety is empty, which again I leave you to check, gives us the following theorem. Take any surfaces in three-dimensional Euclidean space, so S and S prime, and take embedded curves, C and S, C prime and S prime, and then take any diffeomorphism from the curves. It doesn't have to be an isometry in this situation. It just has to be a diffeomorphism, because every diffeomorphism of curves is conformal. There are no angles you can measure on a curve. So, of course, any diffeomorphism of curves preserves angles, since there aren't any angles to preserve. Then that diffeomorphism extends, that local diffeomorphism extends to a local conformal map of an open set of S to an open set of S prime. The reason this works is clearly that there were no characteristics. So if I take that local diffeomorphism C to C prime, I can maybe make, for example, E1 point tangent to C, E1 prime tangent to C prime. Then I can calculate out what the factor is, E to the minus U, that relates motion along C and motion along C prime. The velocity of which the we move along C prime relative to that diffeomorphism, relative to how to move, let's say, at unit rate along C. So that E to the minus U is really that velocity ratio. That enables us to calculate out U. So now we've got a curve in the product frame bundle, and it's an integral curve of omega prime is E to the minus U omega. It's an integral curve for our exterior differential system. And so because there's no characteristic variety, that's a non-characteristic initial curve, and so it lies in an integral surface inside M bar, right? Inside the M bar. So we can see geometrically what we're doing is to calculate not in M, but in M bar. We calculated out this curve, this local diffeomorphism, C to C prime, is expressed as a curve inside that quotient space. And that curve is non-characteristic, and it's an integral curve, and therefore it extends to some integral manifold. It's an integral surface in M bar. In M, we were looking at M integral 3 manifolds, but we've included those rotations of the tangent plane as part of those 3 manifolds, and when we quotient out, they become then integral surfaces in M bar. So the integral 3 manifolds on M become integral surfaces in M bar, and we can find that they have to exist along all these integral curves. So that local diffeomorphism C to C prime gives rise to an integral curve. That integral curve sits at an integral surface, and that's a local conformal map. So we get that extends to a local conformal map, and it's locally unique, again, by the same results. It's a locally unique conformal map. So we get a very nice result. It's somewhat global in the sense that, as usual, you can pick your initial data globally. You can pick these curves to be global objects. You can pick a local diffeomorphism between them. globally all the way along the curves, even though it's a local living morphism, it's globally picked all the way along them, and then you can extend locally. And it's locally unique. So this gives us a sort of global and initial data, but local in the surfaces result about conformal mappings. It shows us some sense of flexibility, gives us some idea of how flexible this sort of thing should be. It also tells us that there are no characteristics, there's no sort of special directions for which we'd run into trouble. And so we're not too surprised if there might actually be some sort of theorem that would enable us to globally conformally map certain kinds of surfaces. So we're not as shocked by say, for example, the Riemann mapping theorem, as we might have been otherwise. So, summarizing the entire series of lectures, exterior differential systems methods only give local analytic solutions. They can't globally solve anything, but they help us to guess what happens more generally, because we have some intuitive sense of what sort of initial value problems we might be able to construct, and how much data we get to pick, and what might be the case. It leads us naturally to lots of interesting conjectures without showing us how to prove them. It gives a picture of how to make initial data. If you can actually compute the characteristic variety out, you have a chance of being able to describe the sort of initial data that would be suitable for starting to build some kind of theory of the solutions of these differential equations. And they allow, even without working out the characteristic variety, to guess how much initial data you get to pick, because they give characters. The Cartan characters can be calculated even without working out the characteristic variety, and they at least allow you to count initial data. They allow us to compute the characteristic variety, which gives us not only some sense of what initial data we can pick, but it also gives us a sense of how flexible the solutions are, because the characteristics should intuitively be something like directions in which you have some sort of extra bendability, flexibility of the solutions. Although, as they say, we have no theorems in that direction, still it gives us some notion that that's where we would look for the ability to flex, and we'd expect more rigidity along other directions.